From the RSNA, I'm Dr. Linda Chu, and welcome to the Radiology Journal podcast. September is when fourth-year medical students in the United States apply for residency positions in a process called a match. Radiology residency has become more competitive in recent years, and Dr. Francis Deng and Dr. Linda Moy summarized these trends in a recent article titled, The U.S. Radiology Residency Match, Update and Multi-Decade Trends. It is my pleasure to chat with Dr. Deng about this hot topic today. Dr. Deng is an assistant professor at Johns Hopkins University and a co-host on the podcast program. Welcome, Francis.
Thank you, Linda.
To begin, would you please discuss the trend in the number of radiology residency positions in the past decades and how it compares with other specialties?
Absolutely. For this centennial volume of radiology, we wanted to take a look at long-term trends in the residency market for radiology in the United States. So we looked at data from the National Resident Matching Program, the NRMP, who facilitates this market. And we looked at the data over the past third of a century, that is since 1991. And tallying the number of positions offered in diagnostic radiology, as well as a smaller number of integrated diagnostic radiology programs with interventional radiology or nuclear medicine, you'd see that the number this year, 1,356 positions, is 65% higher than it was in 1991 when it was 822. So that's nearly a two-thirds increase in positions. And there's been a steady growth for the past 25 years or so. So that sounds impressive, but we also have to look at the broader picture. American medicine has grown as a whole even more than radiology has. So counting the categorical and band specialty programs, these positions in the match have doubled, so a 100% increase. For instance, large fields that have doubled in size since 91, as far as the match goes, include family medicine, internal medicine, psychiatry, and orthopedics.
Along the same lines, what about the trend of radiology residency applicants in the past decades?
Applicants to radiology have grown as well, but not quite as steadily as positions have grown. So if you look at the graph over time, there are a number of peaks and valleys. There was a valley in the 1990s, a peak and a plateau in the 2000s, a valley in the mid-2010s, and now we've reached yet another peak. To better contextualize this, you have to understand that the number of medical students has increased in this country. More medical schools have opened up, medical schools have enlarged in size. So we have to look at the percentage of residency applicants that are applying to radiology to really understand how radiology has changed relative to other fields. So the lowest percentage was in 1997, around 3%, and the highest was in the 2000s at 6 or 7%. And so this dipped below 4% in 2015. And now, in 2023, we're hitting a resurgence with 5.9% of U.S. graduating MD students applying into radiology. So it's not quite as popular as in the heyday of the 2000s, but it's getting back up there.
What are some of the reasons for the variations in the medical students' interest in pursuing radiology?
It's a complicated question. Medical students consider a lot of factors when deciding their specialty. In their graduation questionnaires, the vast majority will say that the content of the specialty and the fit of that specialty with their personality, interests, and skills are the most influential factors, as they should be. But in my opinion, the nature of a specialty is slow to change over time, and the range of personalities of the medical student body doesn't really fluctuate decade to decade. It might change slowly over time. So we have to look at other factors to kind of explain why our field has had some variations. So one major additional factor I think we should consider is the economic health of the specialty. So about half of graduating medical students say that income expectations was a moderate or strong influence on their specialty choice. It turns out that choosing radiology in particular is somewhat elastic to expected earnings, at least more so than other large specialties. Different econometric studies have borne this out over the decades. The most recent one was published as a working paper of the National Bureau of Economic Research by Gottlieb and colleagues. This paper was highlighted in a Washington Post article this summer that made the rounds on social media because it drew a lot of attention to how much doctors actually made based on their tax returns. A very interesting side conclusion from this paper to me was buried in the online appendix that I found that if you model out what specialty students from from the tip-top medical schools choose. You'd predict that a higher earning level would attract more of these competitive students. It's kind of an intuitive conclusion, but the quantitation was really more interesting to me. They wrote in this appendix that increasing radiologist earnings by 6% would increase the share of graduates from the top medical schools, the top five medical schools, who choose radiology by 17%. That, in my opinion, is a remarkably high elasticity. So the fluctuations in medical student interest over the years has some parallels with the job market in radiology, which makes sense if the medical students are looking at income expectation and, you know, whether they'll have a job when they graduate. So the job market was weak in the mid-1990s. It strengthened by the turn of the century and into the 2000s, and weakened again in the early 2010s. In the past 5 years, radiology jobs have seen significant growth. Volumes are up, everyone's hiring, the job boards have a ton of new postings. So I think the feeling about the job market in the present moment trickles down to the medical students. It colors conversations that the residents and fellows have with medical students rotating through. And if you read online forums, students are relatively aware of these trends. So I think it's one important factor to consider when explaining the temporal variation in student interest in our field. Another factor is work-life balance. There's kind of a small but quantifiable shift in the preference of medical students these days for greater work-life balance. So for instance, in the graduation questionnaire, 48% of students in 2023 said work-life balance was a strong influence on their specialty choice. Whereas in 2009, it was 38%. And before that, it wasn't even asked. So I think it was already on people's radar. And I think more people are paying attention to the controllability of lifestyle within different specialties more than ever. And I think COVID put an emphasis on that. And, you know, COVID also catalyzed the mainstream adoption of teleradiology, which a lot more medical students ask about these days because it potentially offers greater lifestyle flexibility. And so, you know, kind of considering those two factors, you know, then we can look at kind of micro trends that have happened as well. So if you look at trends in student interest since the last valley in 2015, it has not been a smooth rise. There was a little peak, a little dip, and then now another peak. I think the dip, is my speculation, is at least in part due to the hype around AI. You know, around this time, Jeffrey Hinton, the godfather of AI, said in 2016, people should stop training radiologists now. Radiologists are like the coyote off the cliff who hasn't looked down yet. I think this spooked a lot of medical students in the early days of AI, but we've now reached a different stage on that hype curve where people have more realistic expectations and radiologists are generally more optimistic about the impact that AI will have on the field, and it hasn't had really much of an impact so far.
As you mentioned earlier, the 2023 radiology residency match was the most competitive match since 2001. Would you please summarize the trends in competitiveness and why it has become so competitive?
It's important to look at a couple different metrics to show that it actually has been more competitive. You know, and I think it's been more competitive for all those reasons I outlined before. But probably the most intuitive way to demonstrate that it has been more competitive is to look at the match rate. So of the people who are applying into radiology, how many of them actually land a position in radiology in the match? And so to do this, I calculated my own version of the match rate, which differs from the official one published every other year, but it's like relatively close by a few percentage points. So for US MD students, the average match rate over the time period that we looked at since 1991 was 89%. And for all applicants, it was 75%. So in periods that it was less competitive, like the late 90s or the 2010s, the match rates for US MD students hovers in the mid-90s, mid-90% range. The most competitive year was in 2001, when the match rate for US MD students was 73%. And so fast forwarding to the future, the match rate has been declining for 3 years in a row. In 2023, the match rate for US MD students was 81%, meaning more than one in six graduating US MD students applying to radiology did not match into radiology. And so for all applicant types, the match rate was 67% this year, which is the lowest it's been since the early 2000s as well.
With your crystal ball, what are your predictions for the 2024 match? Do you think it will become even more competitive?
I think that 2024 will be more competitive. I think the job market right now is still hot. The AI hype is still receding. The work-life balance aspects are still appealing, more appealing than ever. I think we're going to get to the level seen in the 2000s, where 6 or 7% of graduating MD students apply to radiology. And that's probably closer to a level saturation of, you know, how many medical students think radiology is a good fit for their personality and skills and interests.
Thanks for your thorough analysis of the competitiveness of the radiology match. Now I want to explore what it means for applicants and future of the radiology workforce. What is your advice for medical students who are applying for radiology residency? Do you have any special advice for international medical graduates who face an even tougher uphill battle?
I think my advice for both U.S. medical students as well as international medical graduates would be consider applying for a backup specialty. I think there should be no shame in that, and it should not really affect your chances of matching into your first choice specialty if that is radiology. So if you look at the NRMP's results and data, there's always a table that shows you how many people apply to each specialty as their only choice or as their first choice. If first choice implies that they ranked a second specialty lower down. And so if you look at what has changed in the past few years the most in radiology, applicants have dramatically shifted from the only choice column to the first choice column. So they would rather match to a backup specialty than go unmatched altogether and have to delay their life for a year before trying again. There's certainly going to be some people who would think, you know, it's radiology or bust, and they would rather go unmatched and, you know, augment their CV and try again next year. But I think a lot of people would prefer, you know, that they don't feel that strongly. They would rather match to a backup specialty and move on with their life and, you know, go on training in a different specialty. That's something that everyone has to think about, even USMD students in the current environment who are otherwise competitive, but simply because there are so many students applying to radiology these past couple of years that you have to consider the possibility of a backup specialty.
There are also other changes around the corner. When I was an associate program director many years ago, USMLE Step 1 gave a numeric score, and I found that it was a helpful metric to compare medical students from different institutions. Step 1 changed to a pass-fail system in 2022. How do you think it will affect the match process?
There was an interesting paper published in the JACR by Charles Maxfield and colleagues back in 2021 when this change was first announced, and they performed a kind of a hypothetical discrete choice experiment. They surveyed a bunch of program directors and associate program directors to ask them, with these hypothetical candidate profiles, would you offer this person an interview to your program? And so they varied different variables like step scores, the medical school, their class rank, number of publications, their ethnicity, their gender, and so on and so forth. And they kind of compared things when you took step one out of the equation, when step one was pass fail versus when step one was still a numeric score. And they found that when you took step one out of the equation by making it pass fail, essentially, that the things that grew in influence were their step two scores and what the applicant's medical school was. So kind of the reputation of the medical school will have greater influence than it did before. And the importance of step two will be more important than ever before. I think largely step two CK scores will supplant the role it had in resident selection and, you know, selecting applicants for interviews that step one had in the past. It's probably better because people take step two later in their medical school. It's more of a summative kind of assessment for everything you've learned in medical school. Back when I applied to residency, kind of taking step two before you apply for a residency was optional, but really now to be competitive, it's really suggested to take it by the time that you've submitted your applications or certainly by the time you've interviewed.
Lastly, our radiology exam volumes are increasing faster than expansions in our training programs. And many radiologists are burning out under the current pressures to read more and read faster. What are some solutions that can help us cope with these increasing volumes?
It often feels like the amount of work thrown at us is out of our control, but I think we as a field have to take opportunities to exert some influence on the volume of scans that are being performed, because volumes are ever growing, probably spiraling out of control in some places. But I would suggest thinking about solutions like, don't open up more scanner hours before you have adequate radiologist staffing. Try to take opportunities to educate referring providers on appropriate use criteria. If you observe a pattern of very low yield imaging utilization, have a conversation with your referring providers, like, you know, what are you exactly looking for in this situation? What are some other strategies we could have? Try to push back on that a little bit. The other thing I would say is there's always a really tight balance between, you know, adequately staffing our field versus kind of maintaining the positive job market and, you know, economics that our field currently enjoys. I think that's a really tough balance that it's impossible to control centrally because there's no central body that's kind of regulating the size of our residency programs in general versus how well our field is doing economically in general. There's ACGME, but they largely make decisions about whether to allow programs to expand or to open new programs based on whether certain institutions and sites can support the educational mission. Like there are enough faculty, there is enough imaging volume to support more radiology trainees at a particular site. They're not specifically looking at the economic health as a specialty as a whole. But it's always something that I think the leaders in our field have to keep in mind, is that we can't expand our field so fast in order to meet those volumes, but put us at risk of oversaturating our field. And then suddenly our field would be unappealing to incoming medical, incoming residents. And so we have to think about that very tight balance between, you know, the supply and demand of our field and ensuring that on one hand, we're adequately staffed and people aren't burned out, but also we're not oversaturating the field so that the job market is poor and our top medical students don't want to enter our field because of that.
Very well said. Thank you, Dr. Deng, for sharing your insights with us today.
It's my pleasure.
I wish all the radiology residency applicants the best of luck, and I hope that they will match into great programs. This wraps up this week's podcast. Before we go, I want to put in a plug for the RSNA meeting. When you attend RSNA 2023, our industry influencers and radiology trailblazers are set to help you embrace what's next in medical imaging. Imagine what new medical imaging practices and technology can teach about collaboration and innovation. We have everything you need, all in one place as we help you explore how to lead through change. Join us November 26th through the 30th for the biggest week in radiology, in person, virtually, or both. Early bird pricing is available through October 4th. Register now for RSNA 2023 at rsna.org/register. Thank you for tuning in and supporting our podcast program. Please subscribe today on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, or Spotify. Come back next week for a new episode. Take care.